says, "This is the day which the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it." And as everyone knows, we live in a fallen world. And a lot of times, we look at the day based on our circumstances. We look at the day based on whether or not I got enough sleep last night, whether I got in a big argument with my spouse or my kids, whether or not my finances are in order. But no, our day is dictated because God made it. And He made it. What He makes, He says, is good. So we have to get our eyes off of the day-to-day things. We have to get our eyes off of our emotions. We have to get our eyes off of the things that are happening to us and rise up and know that it's time that we connect with God and that we bring what He says about us into this earth. Amen? Because Psalm 139:16 says, "Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be." So we have to know that God looked at each one of us and He created an amazing life for each one of us. He created a life of overcoming. He created a life that we're going to stand up and shout victory because of what Jesus did for us on the cross. Amen. So when we look at this day today, God made this day so that we would overcome any adversity that's in our lives, amen? So I want you to look at what is going on with you today. You said, "No, I am not gonna let you dictate my life. God is who dictates my day, amen? And I am an overcomer. I am a son, I am a daughter of the Most High God. And I'm gonna walk out in victory, amen?" And that's why we shout in victory. That's why we rejoice. Because no matter what is going on, no matter what the world says about me, I know that there is a higher calling that says something completely different. Amen. So as we transition into our tithes and our offerings, our time of giving, let's remember that rejoicing as we give back to the Lord today. God, we thank you, Jesus. If the ushers would just come forward. And we are about to march into our new place that God has for us right down the street on Blanding Boulevard. And we are taking that place by faith. And God knows He wants you to continue to sow your seeds, whether it's helping out in the building, financial, whatever you can do, prayer. Sow these seeds so that we can occupy this territory that heaven already declared over us. Amen. So bow your heads with me today. Father God, we thank you, God, for the victory that Jesus died for on the cross, Father. God, and we thank you, God, that we would see, God, what is written in your books over each one of us, Father. God, we thank you, God, that it's a life of overcoming. Lord, it's not a life of lesser than, Father God, but you declared a good life over each one of us, Father. God, and let us rise up today, Father God, and grab hold of that word that's over each one of us today, Father. God, and we just praise you, God, as we give back to you today, Father God. Lord, it's so much smaller than what you give to us, Father. And let us know that. Let us hold you up, Father God, and say praise and thanks, Father God, for all that you give us, Father. God, and multiply your kingdom, Father God, on this earth, Father. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'm no longer a slave of fear, 'cause I am a child of God. And I'm no longer a slave to fear, 'cause
Maybe tomorrow? Okay. Finally. Bless the Lord. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. And after you have done everything to stand, stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted for the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all of this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people.
Came, stole my mind, wrapped my soul in chains. Now I live among the dead, fighting voices in my head, hoping someone hears me crying in the night and carries me away. Set me free.
Captive free, Jesus. Wow, hallelujah.
Amen.
Woo. How about it for the drama team, huh? Amen. I can tell you one thing, that's going to look pretty impressive on a 70-foot stage.
Yeah.
We got a lot more room for a lot more people to come and see the message of Jesus.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Woo. Hallelujah. You have a seat right there? All right. Now, I wanted to let you all know yesterday, we had middle schoolers, please, guys, go, don't mess up my office now. I love to see that group, though, man. It just is growing.
Amen.
Hallelujah. You know, yesterday we had a couple of outreaches going on. We had men going to men's prison ministry yesterday. And we also had a contingent going again to Tanglewood and ministering to the people there. And what was really cool is what they had done now, this is their third time going there, and they had prayed for this home, this empty home, and now there's a family in it. Hallelujah. I mean, that is so awesome. And then they also have interacted with some of the people there who are all starting to notice that there's a church body that's been coming into their neighborhood. So they're looking forward to coming to Freedom Destiny Church to check out what the Lord's doing here, to go to these people, to go help them, you know, that they can see these people going out. So, you know, one of the things that's always great is, hey, preach the gospel at all occasions, but when necessary, use words. And so these people that are here amongst us, and if you want to be a part of that, they're going out and ministering to these people and just blessing people. So if you want to get involved with that, you know, please see Gina Wells, and specifically for Tanglewood, that's Joshua Stearns. And, you know, just get involved. And if you want to get involved in the drama team, you know, please see Lockie Robbins about that. So, you know, and we just are so grateful you're here today. Also, I wanted, where's Vaughn and Becky? Okay, could you guys please stand up? This is Vaughn and Becky Collins, okay? This is that family I told you about that just moved from Connecticut, and we had thought when he left last week, they were planning to move in today. Well, that's been delayed, and it's likely going to be Tuesday. And so please watch, you know, for emails, and if anyone can come out and help, and we're not sure the location yet, so I just wanted you to see them, and they're here, and this is their church home, and we want to welcome them. If anyone can come out and help on Tuesday, more information to follow, but many hands make light work. So just think about when you move if you wanted some help. So just that's Vaughn and Becky, and they have two children there, and I don't want to make the kids stand up because when I was a teenager, that's the last thing I wanted to do. But it's Samantha and Clay are their two children, and so we're looking forward to welcoming them then into the youth ministry as well, okay? Well, Samantha stood up, so welcome y'all. Now, before we get to the message, I'd like to have the lights come down because we have a video that we want to show you all. So go ahead and bring the lights down, and you guys can go ahead and play that video. I'm sorry? It's not working. No, I'm not happy about that. What's the prognosis? There isn't any yet. Okay? So is it, you can bring the lights back up. That's okay. This is what happens, right? Remember, you guys got families. Things don't go as planned. Okay. Is it possible? Hello? Is it possible or no? Okay. So we're going to move on. Okay.
Yes.
So before we get going then, we're going to pray. Father God, I thank you, Lord, for technology. I thank you, Lord, for fixing bugs. I thank you, Lord, for the blessings you bestowed upon us as we've so far praised and worshiped you with song and then with dance. Father God, we are so grateful for the blessings of people that are new here, Lord, to reach and do outreaches, that Father God, and we thank you, Lord, for the Collinses being here, Lord. And as Candace and I go forward, Lord, I ask you to bless me and Candace, Father God, to speak through us, Father God, to minister to the people, Father God, that their hearts are open, that their minds will be receiving things to renew their minds, Father God. And I thank you, Lord, and ask for your continued blessings over us in Jesus' mighty and matchless name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Go ahead, ma'am.
Amen. All right. Well, I feel like we've already had a lot of deliverance this morning with the wonderful worship. We're no longer slaves, and then set me free. That was powerful, wasn't it? What? Let's give the drama team a hand.
Yeah. Amen. Amen.
That's right. It's going to be really exciting to see how God's going to use our new facility and our larger stage for them to be able to really bring forth God's anointing. God's anointing flows in so many different formats, not just through music, but through drama, through art, through a lot of different expressions of who God is. And even today, as we talk about Fruitful Foundations, since that's the title of today's message, I want you to begin to think about how you perceive things, how you see certain things that are happening in the world around you, even how you choose to build things in your life, the sight that God might give you. And
and they were able to fix this
video.
Well,
hallelujah.
And before we get
Good.
Going, we want you to bring the lights
yes.
down. Bear with us and
yes.
watch this screen before we get to the Fruitful Foundation.
Yes, look at this Fruitful
ties in.
Foundation.
This ties in. Go ahead. Play the video.
Just survive. Oh, you will see me thrive. Can write my story. I'm beyond the archetype. I won't just conform. No matter how you shake my core. Cause my roots, they run deep. So little faith, don't doubt it, don't doubt it. Victory is in my veins. I know it, and I will not negotiate. I'll fight it, I'll fight it. I will transform. When the fire's at my feet again, oh, and the
gushes are unbelievable.
Yes. Look at your neighbor and say, you are a champion. That's right. Yes, we are definitely champions in Jesus. And he is definitely giving us all we need. How many churches can say that they built their own facility from the ground up? Uh-huh. That's right. You give a hand clap to yourselves.
Let me comment on that. We are changing that place from the inside out, just like the Lord changes us from the inside out. That's exactly what's going on. And so many of you that have been a part of that, and some of you maybe, you can still come out and be a part of this. Listen, we're not quitting. No. There's so many things that are trying to prevent us from stopping, but we are not going to stop. Yeah. We are going to rise.
That's right. When you have it on the inside of you, it doesn't make a bit of difference what the enemy throws at you. You just keep rising higher and higher and higher. Because you have a power on the inside of you that won't quit. And that's what's driving these people. Every single week, they show up to this building, and they show up faithfully. That's what's driving Pastor Adam. That's what's driving me, is the power of the Holy Spirit, God that will not allow us to quit. I know he wakes some of you all up in the middle of the night and tells you to pray for this, and keeps you up and has you pray for Pastor Adam and I, and you have no idea how much we need your prayers at this time. This is the biggest project that we have ever been involved in to this degree, and the forces that we face on a daily basis are beyond comprehension. But with your support and continued prayers and believing in this vision, this is going to come to pass, and we are not that far from it. It just means that we have to keep going and not quit. And then we're going to say, we made it to the promised land, and we really are not slaves any longer in this building, to this building. Right? We're free on the inside. We're just looking forward to step into a place that is going to really share the love of Jesus at another level. Having that larger facility to be able to allow worship and the word and the drama and the deliverances and the healings and the transformation that people are going to be able to receive in all aspects of that place. I'm amazed even today that whenever we go over there, there is prayer, there's people ministering to one another. It's not even so much about all the things that we're doing with our hands, but it's about the heart of the place. And so God is already moving in so many mighty ways in that building. So make sure you plan to come out there on a Thursday or a Saturday. You at least don't want to miss part of that process. And I can't stress enough, those people who have blessed us with food, we cannot thank you enough for that. Those who come out every Saturday, twice on Saturdays, Thursday nights, and have blessed us, all that is serving the Lord in every capacity. I had a conversation with Pastor Adam and Alex the other day, and it touched my heart so much because it shows how much God is rebuilding our church from the inside out. We're not only building, but we're rebuilding. And the three of us were having a conversation, and we have been through quite a lot of transition, and we asked our daughter, we says, what defines Freedom Destiny for you? And she said, we're a serving church. She said, this place, everyone in this place serves. And we had a visitor come to our building on Thursday night. A first time he's ever met Pastor Adam and I, first time he's ever stepped into the new facility or even over here. And he was in the building for just a couple minutes, and he looked at us and he said, are these all the people that go to the church? We said, yes. I mean, this is a small portion, but yes, these are the people of the church. And he said, I've never seen so much serving. He says, these people serve like this? We said, yes, they do. They serve like this. Like, they are driven by God's desire on the inside of them to serve. It's not obligation. It's not duty. It's desire. And desire is what makes the difference, and that's what makes us great servants in our home and outside our home. And that's where we're going to go today when we talk about Fruitful Foundations. Because in order for there to be a real change anywhere, in order for God to meet us in the foundation of anything that he is building in and through us, in our homes, in our churches, in our workplaces, in our cities, in our towns, our regions, wherever we're at, in our country for that matter, we have to have God's vision and be operating in it. And we have to make sure that we have God's heart. We have to have God's heart for our own families. What is it that God wants to do in your family? Have you ever asked him, have you really sat down and asked him, like, you might compare your family to another family and think, well, God wants to do in my family what he's doing in this family. But no, you're a unique Christian family. God has a unique vision for your family. What does he want to do in your family? And so when we begin to ask God those kinds of questions, God, what do you want to do in this church? This church is unique from other churches. And in our families and our churches and our towns and our jobs, they all have a unique flow. But we have to grab a hold of what does God want to do in the midst of our homes and our workplaces and these kinds of things. And we have to meet God where he's at. Now, in order for us to be successful in building anything and to develop a good foundation, we have to know what not to do. And so I'm going to start today by talking about what do we not do, all right? So let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 3, and I want to go through a few verses here. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 3 through 4. We're always striving for God's purity and wholeness in whatever foundation we have to be building. But a lot of times our flesh and our own carnality, our own immaturity get in the way of God's intention for what he wants to build in our personal lives and in our families. And you know, I didn't mean to exclude that, because you're just as much of the temple of the Holy Spirit as it is your home environment. A lot of little temples in there. And then we're all the temple of the Holy Spirit here in this larger sanctuary. Because, you know, the church is not a building. The church is people. Look to your neighbor and say, you the church.
You the church.
You the church. And so we got to know what not to do in order to often know what to do. A lot of times things don't work out for us in life because we're ignorant of what not to do. And we don't even sometimes have enough understanding of what to do. So we get stuck in these places. And sometimes it's not even sin that keeps us from the plan and purpose of God. It's just simply not knowing what to do or what not to do. It could just be that we just have to learn some foundational things. So in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, Paul is talking to the Corinthian church. And the church at Corinth was a difficult place to plant a church, let me tell you. There was a lot of things that were going on in that particular city that was really rough. But here's the Apostle Paul, and he's talking to the people, and they're building their church. And he says to them, listen, you're kind of still immature. He says, you're worldly. And he's hoping that they're going to grow. All apostles and all pastors, they want to see their people grow. And we're all growing. We're all at different levels. We're all growing. So he says to them, listen, you're worldly. He says, and this is how he says he knows. He goes, because there's still jealousy and quarreling among you. And he says, you're acting like mere humans. Well, of course we're going to act like humans, right? We're mere humans, we're acting like, okay? But he's expecting something greater for them than to act like a mere human. He's saying, listen, when you're mature in Christ, you understand your humanity, but you know how to overcome. See, we're all going to be human in certain instances. Are we going to quarrel and are we going to be jealous? Yes, all of these are factors of being human. However, we can overcome. You just have to have a soul that's trained to understand what's God and what's not. So he says, listen, he brings it to this particular example. He says, this is how I know you're being immature. He goes, because some of you say, I follow Paul and I follow Apollos. He goes, that's what humans do. Humans follow one another. They don't follow God.
Come on. Come on, sister.
I got a sister on that one. Follow. We follow people. We're supposed to follow God. If you're going to build a fruitful foundation in your home, don't follow the Smiths next door. Trust me, they don't know what they're doing. The Joneses on the other side have no idea what's up. You do. Set a firm foundation in your home. So then he goes to say in verse 5, he says, after all, who is Apollos? What is Apollos? And what is Paul? He's saying, who are we? And he's referring to himself. He goes, you know what? Don't follow me. Follow God. He says, only servants through whom you came to believe. That's all we are. The Lord has assigned each of us servants a task. And then he goes on to talk about himself. He goes, I, Paul, planted the seed, but Apollos watered it. But God is the only one that can make it grow. So neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but only God who makes things grow.
Hallelujah.
The one who plants and the one who waters have one purpose, and they will each be rewarded according to their own labor. Look to your neighbor and say, do you plant or water?
Do you plant or water?
Get to know your neighbor. We're all co-workers in God's service. We're God's field. We're God's building. We are the building of God. And each one of us has been given a certain realm of jurisdiction, something that God calls us to, a realm. Apollos had his realm. Paul had his realm. And they each function within that realm. But the problem comes when people are following only Apollos and following only Paul, and they forget the real basis that God only has you connected to certain people for certain times and seasons to accomplish certain things, but it's not the people you should be following, it's God you should be following. We need to have good leaders, for sure, good leaders, but ultimately you're following God. And when you're going to build your house or your personal home where all of you and your family members dwell, it should be God's house first, because if God's not building it, the laborers labor in vain, right?
Right.
We don't want to do anything in vain. And let's go down to 1 Corinthians, because this helps us understand. Because Paul says, look, he says, God has given me grace. This is verse 10. He says, I laid a foundation as a wise builder. And someone else, another minister, somebody else, there was another person there, is building on what he started. Now, I meditated on this because I thought to myself, Paul, you professed in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 that you laid a foundation as a wise builder. I had to scratch my head and say, well, what are the characteristics of a wise builder? He referred to himself as being one. So what did Paul know that the rest of us don't know? Because he could even claim that he is a wise builder. I mean, honestly, I'll tell you the truth, I did not think I could look in the mirror and say, I'm a wise builder. You would not find that coming out. Whether it came out from a spiritual sense or even from a natural sense. Clearly, being over at that building consistently lets me know I do not know what I am doing. That is clear. Very clear. And most people tell you I'm one of the best supervisors in the place. I'm sure I got some people talking behind my back going, Pastor Candy, come over here, and she don't do much. She just watches us work. Come on, I already heard what you're saying. Come on, come on, come on. Pastor Candy, she's always talking to everybody. Listen, somebody got to do ministry in that building. That's my job. That's my job. So you see me over there talking to everybody, it's because I'm ministering. Don't you forget it. Okay. Just getting my position in place. That's right, I'm working for God. That's right. Pastor says to me, you coming over there? I need you over there, but stop distracting everybody. You got to work. I am working. My work just looks different than your work. We're still working. Just looks different.
That's good. That's okay. I got the mic next.
Uh-oh.
I love you.
I love you, too. Yeah. I couldn't do this job if you weren't there working.
Amen.
That's right. Somebody got to be doing it. Come on. That's right. He leads the charge. Come on, how many of y'all would not even be over there if he was not over there? That's right. He leads by example because he's there and motivates everybody else to get up and go too. Right? What if he just dictated an order and never showed up over there? I mean, what's the point of that? What kind of leader is that doesn't serve and serve by example? This man is the best example of servanthood I have ever seen. That's right. That's right.
Well, now you kind of took the mic out of my hand.
I It's all right. So, where was I? All right. I was working. I'm a good supervisor. Mm-hmm. What you doing? That looks good. Let's go over here. Okay. All right. So Paul's saying, listen, he's a wise builder. And he says, each one should build with care. For no one can lay any foundation other than the one that is already laid, which is Christ Jesus. We can't do anything other than on the foundation of Jesus Christ. If we begin to build any house on any other foundation than the strength of Jesus Christ, the house is going to fall, right? So Paul knows this. So that's one thing to being a wise builder is you build it on Jesus Christ, right? But then he says this, if anyone builds on this foundation using gold, silver, costly stones, wood, hay, or straw, their work will be shown for what it is because the day will bring it to light. Now, this is where I want to rest. Okay, so this makes us ask the question then, what are we using to build? Build ourselves, build our personal homes, build this church? What are we using? And God began to speak to me, and he began to say, you want to make sure that no wood, hay, or straw is built on the foundation of this house. Now listen to what I'm going to say to you. And this goes for you personally, okay? Look at yourself and say, me personal. Then say, my family. Then say, this church. And then say, this town. All right? Now, what is hay, straw, wood? What does that look like in your life? That's good-looking flesh. What will kill you personally, your home, this church, or anything else around you for that matter that you try and build on is good looking flesh. Flesh can look really good. We know flesh that looks really bad. Oh, you can spot it. You can spot bad looking flesh. But good looking flesh, that's a tough one. Because good looking flesh looks good. So we think it's good. So we start using it to build. Until all of a sudden, what does the word say? The word says fire comes in and begins to test. It says that fire will test the quality of each person's work. And if what has been built survives, the builder will receive a reward. In other words, the test is coming. And when it comes, what's going to be left that you've built on the foundation? See, you just don't want to walk around with that foundation. You better have some walls there. You better have a roof there. You better have some floors that go on top of the foundation. You better have some plumbing in that place. You better have some electrical or there's not going to be any lights on. You better have some stuff taking place in there. But if it's just good looking, when the fire comes, it's going down. So this is where we need to assess for ourselves what is good-looking flesh in our own life. That's a tough one. Look to your neighbor and say, what's good-looking flesh?
What's good-looking flesh?
What's good-looking flesh? That's going to look different to each one of us. It depends on your eyesight. For some of y'all, good-looking flesh looks one way, and for somebody else, good-looking flesh looks another way. But what God wants to remind us of is we can't be building anything on flesh and carnality. Now, you can be a Christian, but you can be a carnal Christian. You can be born again and baptized in the Holy Ghost, and you can be as carnal as get all. Right? Your carnality looks good to the world, and somebody's going to pat you on the back for it. I'm going to say, man, that thing looking good. You just better keep dressing like that. You just better keep looking like that. That's looking good. All right. But it's false. Okay, now I'm talking to everybody out there. I'm especially talking to artists out there, okay? Today, if you're a creative artist, okay? People flow in creativity here, right? We always pray for God's creative miracles to come forth. And inside each and every one of us is an artist of some sort, okay? Because
that aspect of God flows through us in so many areas, okay? And I'm not necessarily talking about artists as in your painter. Maybe you express yourself in poems or you know, I mean, there's just a whole long list of ways we express ourselves, right? Each one of us are artists in our own right, okay? What is looks good to you and your artistry may not at all be bringing forth the glory of God. It's truth. We get all wrapped up in television and media and all that kind of thing. And, you know, that's culture, right? That's our culture. And you see, Paul's trying to say, listen, wood, hay, and stubble is stuff that's built like that. And when it's tested by fire, it's not going to stand. And you're going to have to go back down to the foundation again and rebuild if you want it to be glorious in me. Now, listen, this is for all of us, okay? I'm not preaching at you. I'm preaching with you. I'm a member of this church just like everybody else is. I see and understand these things just like y'all see and understand them. God convicts me the same way he convicts you. The question is, will we respond to the conviction that we receive? Who wants to see the real glory of God in this house? Yes, Lord. Who wants to see the real glory of God on the inside of you? That's right, in your home, all of that. Then what we need to remember is we have to know that we cannot build on these false things, which means you've got to have wisdom to ask God, is that just good-looking flesh? God, or is this really a expression of the glory of God coming forth that's going to bring you the ultimate glory, God? If we go home and begin to ask those serious questions, God's going to tell you to let go of some good-looking things in your life. They're good-looking things. We all have them. But what is most important to him is purity and wholeness and building on a fruitful foundation. So I'm going to close up here because Pastor Adam's going to come up. But here's the last scripture I want to bring forth, okay? John chapter 15, verse 8. So you got the idea. If we're going to be mature and we want to reveal the glory of God, we have to assess what is carnal in our life and what is wood, hay, and stubble. Because I'm telling you, the fire's coming to burn it. And if it starts going away, let it go. Don't hold on to it. Because the glory of God is about ready to come forth, and that stuff has got to be burnt in order for that to happen. See, anytime that it looks like there's a blockade or an obstacle, really all it is an opportunity that God is about ready to send something better. That's how he does, but you have to change your thinking to know that. So in John chapter 15, verse 8, in the book of John, John says, Jesus says this, is to my Father's glory, okay? And this is repeated by John. This is my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. Okay, so how do we got to build? We have to build a fruitful foundation, one where God's Spirit is bringing forth fruit, which then will reveal the glory of God, and it will look good. It just won't be good-looking flesh. It'll be good spirit and glory. And this is where we, as Christians, have to ask God for the discernment. What's good-looking flesh, and what's fruit that's being born to the glory of God? We all have the capability of bringing forth fruit because if you are born again and you've received Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you have the Holy Spirit on the inside of you. He always wants to bring forth fruit. What stops the process is the soul, the mind, will, and emotions because they're stuck up in the carnality of the world and into the good-looking things. All right, I'm going to leave you with that thought.
Amen. Thank you, Dyer. It was Monday evening, and Pastor Candace was with our youngest daughter, Samantha, in Tampa as she's preparing for college. And so there was this parent orientation, so she was there. And I texted her Monday evening, and I said, hey, we're gonna do this together on Sunday, and here are some things that I want you to build around because this is what the Lord is leading me to talk about. And so they were these three phrases that I texted her, and they were, not living in the Word produces bad things. Choosing deception is wrong. And the third one is, if we ignore immorality, watch out. So, I was reflecting on those phrases, and I was reminded that many people paid with their lives for our right to own a Bible. The number of people that have paid with their life, we couldn't count that number. So that you and I right now could read the Word of God. And for too many of us, this hard-won treasure of a Bible lies buried under the dust and debris of our lives. The Lord's plan calls for His people to live and breathe His Word, to read it and receive it inwardly, and to think about it regularly and to practice it. Not just read it, but to practice it. God intended for His Word to become part of the very marrow of our bones. He said we're to digest it, we're to assimilate to it, we're to live it, and we're to meditate upon it continually. He even told His people to eat this book. Several times throughout the Bible, it says that God told His faithful prophets to consume the book containing His words. Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and in Revelation, it says this. The idea behind all this is to get the Word inside of us. Just like we were saying, the building, we're building it out from the inside out. We're changing it. We get changed from the inside out because we're taking in His Word, and it changes us. It gives us a new heart. We circumcise that part of our heart that is not right. So to digest it, as surely as we take in food, we take in meat and vegetables for nourishment and for sustenance. To grow spiritually, just like we grow naturally from the food we eat. Now, Job says this. Job chapter 23, verse 12. I have esteemed the words of His mouth more than my necessary food. Now, Jesus says this, recorded for us in Matthew 4:4. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Now, Jesus knows that this was recorded in Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 3 as well. The image of taking food and having it become part of our being is the perfect metaphor that for us as God's kids, we're a child of God. We were just singing the song. For God's kid, this is a perfect metaphor to understand receiving the Word and assimilating it into our lives. Man is to live by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. But sadly, too few Christians are living that truth today. Now, notice I said Christians. Of course, non-Christians are not living it right, but too many Christians are not living right. And the consequences of that negligence are horrendous. Have you paid attention? If you know anything about history, our culture is going down the sewer.
That's right.
See, when God's people are not living in the Word, their soul, Pastor Ken is just talking, their soul may be saved, but their minds have remained pagan. We've got to admit this reality, ladies and gentlemen. See, when over 75% of the population says they're Christians, how could our culture be the way it is? The Bible tells us, you hear it from me, right? Romans 12:2. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. See, so when our minds are not renewing to what happened on the inside of us, the bold, right? The baby Christian then will continue to do those things which God has forbidden. The uninstructed Christian will teach. Now, these are uninstructed Christians will teach what seems to be right to them, this good-looking flesh thing that Pastor Candace was just talking about. They'll teach that. And will put stumbling blocks in the path of those unaware of what's going on. In other words, other baby Christians. So we got baby Christians teaching baby Christians. What's that going to produce? The culture we're in. I'm telling you. Right? You don't have to be very smart to figure this out. You just have to be able to observe what's going on. Okay? When God's people are ignorant of the Word, they become sitting ducks. sects, for cults, for false prophets, and for nutty religious schemes. See, folks, when Christians do not know the word, they go after everything that glitters. That's exactly what Pastor Candace was just telling us. How's that flesh looking? Okay? They go after everything that claims to be biblical, even when it's corruption of the very word of God. They respond to gimmicks, they respond to glitter, and they respond to goofballs. Amen. See, when God's people are not living in the word, even when they do open the Bible, they can't find their way around it. In other words, the Bible's truths seem like mysteries to them. The riches of the Bible are lost to them, and its instructions go unheeded as they walk in darkness. The Bible says in Psalm 119:105, the word is a lamp unto my feet, a light unto my path. Another way to describe a Christian not living in the word is to say they remain carnal. Pastor Candace just mentioned that. See, their wisdom is worldly, and it's described in the Bible in James chapter 3, verse 15, as earthly, as sensual, and as demonic. Their lives are governed by the same principles as those that are unsaved. I use this phrase. I like to say, they know so much that isn't so. Let that sink in. They're spewing a lot of stuff, and it equates to nothing. See, and if you pay close attention to them discussing the things of God, you will hear them say things like, it seems to me, or I feel. You may even hear someone admit, I don't know what the Bible teaches about this, but I know what I believe. I mean, right there is the very height of spiritual arrogance and ignorance. See, when Christians are not living in the word, they remain as babies. The scripture describes them this way, Hebrews chapter 5, verse 12. For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the first principles of the oracles of God, and you have come to need milk and not solid food. A huge challenge for ministers is if they're unable to find godly and mature men and women to serve in leadership positions, that will only compound the problems by placing immature people, carnal people, in key positions. For instance, it's hard to describe the challenge a pastor faces when they serve alongside leaders who do not understand faith. Or possibly believe that the pastor is a hired hand and approach ministry only through the lenses of appearances, which is just what Pastor Candace was talking about, and numbers, for instance, right? And become authoritative and divisive if their opinions aren't followed. Like, I'm going to leave that place because they don't let me do what I want to do when I want to do it, because don't they know who I am? I'm a child of God, and I should be able to talk whenever I want to. People have left here because we say, you know, you can come up, and this is a prophetic church. And so if you have something that you want to share with the people, we want to hear it. But I'm not going to let any nut job just come up here. Amen. So just because you're feeling something doesn't necessarily mean it's going to happen unless I feel it too. Because if the dad ain't feeling it, you ain't getting the microphone. So people have left because they said, I thought this was a prophetic church, and Pastor Adam won't let me speak. The reason Pastor Adam won't let you speak, because it's not for everybody, it's for you so that you get glorified. And if you're out there right now, I am sorry to tell you the truth, but be mad at God, because that's what God says. Decently and in order. See, now, I know that there are many people right here, right now, because we found out, I guess, this week that people are saying that the Zika virus is in Florida. So many people are concerned about that. But you know what I'm concerned about? I'm way more concerned about certain destructive Christian doctrines. They're not Christian. They're just these teachings of men that are spreading like an epidemic throughout Christian circles. And this is not a new development within Christianity. In the first decades of Christianity, Paul sternly warned his young mentor, Pastor Timothy, about certain doctrines and preachers who knew how to slice and dice God's word to make it fit to what the people wanted to hear. He writes this in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 3 and 4. He says, "For a time is coming when people will no longer listen to sound and wholesome teaching. They will follow their own desires and will look for teachers who will tell them whatever their itching ears want to hear." Now, while the Bible sharply rebukes the teachers of this dangerous doctrine, Paul is also warning the people who ravenously consume this distorted message. The warning is perfectly clear. Be careful what you listen to. There are false doctrines circulating today. Now, there are a few that I just want to talk about right now. And I'm not saying this to tick anybody off. I'm not saying this to try to be divisive here or anything. I am sharing this out of love of a father that wants to right his children's misthinking. Okay? And I'm also not suggesting that you make it, after you hear these, your lifelong goal to shut these other people up. Okay? Amen. That are preaching these heresies. That's not what I'm sharing this for. I am sharing this, and I'm suggesting that you never, ever should submit to this teaching or support it financially. Don't ever believe these lies I'm going to share, because, you know, it's going to sting for some of you, because I know some of you have bought into this in the past, and maybe you're seeing the light now, and maybe you'll see the light today. But here's the first lie. People teach that you do not have to repent of your sin. Now, it's also true that there are many legalistic and, you know, Christians out there that don't really understand God's love and forgiveness. But that does not mean that you swing the pendulum from that way all the way to the other way and go, man, you can just do anything you want all the time. But you're a Christian because the grace of God covers it all. See, it doesn't mean, God is not lazy about sin, folks. Amen. Right? God is still holy, and true understanding of grace gives us the power to live a holy life. See, if a preacher minimizes repentance or says you should never worry about sin in your life, I am telling you, I am warning you, you should run out that door. And if you can go talk to him, you should. Make an appointment and go talk to him. And if that is something that he says no, then you should say, thank you very much. It's been great being here, but we're going to leave. Amen. Okay? Here's a second lie. You can live however you want to live sexually. Jesus himself warned us in Revelation chapter 2, verses 20 through 23, about the influence of this thing called the Jezebel spirit in the church, right? Jesus said that this spirit was leading Christians to commit acts of immorality. You can see tolerance of sexual sin in many segments of the church today. It's like people are being mentored by Jezebel and they don't know it. Jesus tells us this Jezebel spirit will call itself a prophet, a teacher. It will seduce people, and it lives in rebellion, and it has a very turbulent life. The spirit of Jezebel is a seducing spirit. Seduce means to lure or entice away. It will lure and entice people away from sound teaching. This spirit knows how to build because it builds what's called, it controls us by these soul ties, okay? It connects, what do I mean? It will connect. This Jezebelian spirit will connect with your hurts, will connect with your pains, will connect with the needs that you have and your hunger to hear a prophetic word from God, but it won't be from God what you're hearing. See, the problem with the Jezebel is that this demonic spirit will lead you away from the only one that can help you, and that's Jesus Christ. Amen. Right? And this spirit has adapted so well to today's times that Jezebel is really good on social media. See, The Jezebelian spirit is especially drawn to prophetic circles and comes across as very spiritual. But there's a big difference between spiritual and biblical, right? And this Jezebelian spirit is very good at hiding its fears and its insecurities. Jezebel is very moody. Jezebel has a temper, and it often has bouts of depression. Jezebel loves being fed with personal information about your life and will use that information against you. And if you're not careful, that spirit will damage and destroy your relationship with other people, will destroy and damage your marriage, and it will destroy and damage your ministry. See, the Jezebelian spirit is a demonic spirit pretending to be concerned with your well-being. So don't be deceived by that one, folks. Okay? Here's a third one. Here's a third lie. That you can buy God's blessings. Listen. Candace and I do not preach a poverty gospel. We believe in prosperity. Okay? But the prosperity gospel that emerged in this country in the 1980s has almost ruined our witness. Amen. Right? The greedy televangelists who manipulate audiences to give so that they can buy airplanes or mansions or fancy cars, right, is just plain wrong. Amen. And something else I want to say, just in case those, you know, these preachers who promise people healings or special gifts or the salvation of loved ones in exchange for a seed offering, they need to repent. Amen. See, folks, God's blessings are free. Amen. Right? Shame on those who merchandise God's anointing. We give, folks, because we're grateful for what God did through his son, Jesus Christ, for you and I. We give because we're obeying God because he simply says to give. That should be enough for us. That's why we do it, to obey. The last lie I want to talk about is that people preach that God says we don't suffer, that we're never to suffer. Folks, whenever the church enters a time of prosperity and ease, the message tends to get soft. This happened during the 1980s again, when preachers in silk ties would tell us we could name and claim whatever we wanted in Jesus' name. And yes, these verses they quoted are talking about faith, and they certainly apply to prayer. Okay? Understand me here. That's right. We got to believe by faith. Okay? But the mixed message they sent with this idea that life with God is like a bowl of cherries and that any hardship that comes your way is from the devil is wrong teaching. These preachers avoided lots of scriptures. For instance, 1 Peter 4:1, which says, "Therefore, since Christ has suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves also with the same purpose." That's what the Bible says over and over. Jesus himself talked about it. Man, carry your cross daily. I carried a cross. You got to carry it daily. Die to self. It's all about dying to self. It's all about not doing certain things. Just abstain, whatever it is, from certain type of sexual problems to alcohol to gossip. Abstain. The Christian is dying to the self of that. You're changed from the inside out. Don't let your flesh go, "No, I'm going to start talking about Jack, and I'm going to talk about Jill." You know, and no, I want to go after Jack or I want to go after Jill because you're confused about your sexuality. And a ministry that says that's okay and doesn't point out what God's word says about it, that you're to abstain from that, is not teaching you the truth. But that's not to say you can't be a Christian, but you're getting your mind renewed while you struggle with these certain temptations. Are you understanding what I'm saying here? See, some of these preachers are so proud that they fleece the flock and claim they never have had struggles of their own. And it's so sad to watch and listen to people who follow a minister because they have a $1 million home or a 4-car garage. Well, that's what I want. Now, the Bible does say to honor your minister with double honor. But listen, the Bible also says to much is given, much is expected. I mean, that's what the Bible says. as a leader, you're supposed to be showing them and leading the way, not saying do as I say, but not as I do. If you're being blessed with a lot of material wealth, you better be redistributing it. Just let it pass through, man. Don't hang on to it, because if you do, I'm telling you, you're going down. You're going to be humbled. See, I would recommend that you follow the shepherd with a limp. See? Now, what I mean by that is the preacher who says Christians don't suffer has likely never felt the fire of God's testing. But like Pastor Candace said, it's coming at some point. It's going to come. And this person that says that is likely an illegitimate son, since he has never known the father's discipline. See, and it seems that month after month, if you pay any attention to what's going on in our Christian culture that we have here, we read about another pastor that is too proud to humble themselves and therefore are humiliated publicly because they wouldn't repent privately. It happens way too frequently, right? Or possibly it just appears that they're a shyster. I hate to say it. Now I'm going to ask the band to come up here, please. See, folks, God is cleaning up his church today, right? And he's refining this message, right? Don't prop up or support false doctrines of the past, folks. Purge their influence from your mind. Renew your mind. Right? Embrace the true gospel. The message calls for us, folks, to take up our cross, to repent, to humble ourselves daily. It's not a one-time thing. It's not just because, oh, yeah, I did that last year, I'm good to go. No, every day you have opportunities to either make the choice of life or death. Folks, I know this may come across as a little harsh, but you've got to grasp the reality. What we're praying for, preparing for. You know, listening to my daughter, my oldest, tell us this week what she thinks Freedom Destiny is known for is a serving church. Man, that is, if that's really what everybody else thinks, I am extremely pleased. Because we're supposed to be. That's what Jesus said. I came to serve. I'm showing you the way. He is the leader of all leaders. He said, I came to serve. Let me, if that's all you get today about being wanting to be a Christian as well, does that mean I can be a Christian then if I like to serve? You bet. You bet. You need to reawaken that gift in you and receive Jesus Christ, because that's why he came. He came for those who are lost, who have a problem with sin. He came for those. He said, I am here for you. I love the lost. I love the broken. That skit that was done up here, if you read those words, he came for you, if that described you in any way, shape, or form. That's what he came for. And he's here to throw the demonic out of your life and be the master of your life. You just have to believe in him. Confess that out of your mouth. Believe it in your heart. Confess it, folks. And watch what he'll do. And hang around people that can continue guiding you and maturing you to grow in what it means to be a Christian. Now, we're going to have the altar team up here to pray with you. We receive communion here. It's in the back. And Christians do this because they do it to remember what Jesus Christ did for them. The bread represents his body that was beaten. The grape juice represents his blood that was shed for us. And we do that, and we take some time to continue praising and worshiping the Lord that way, called communion. We fellowship with him, in other words. So folks, I'm going to ask you to rise to your feet and continue praising and worshiping our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.